Life is about numbers. Run the numbers. Do the numbers add up? Age is only a number. Strengthen numbers. Numbers too big to ignore. Looking at the numbers associated with this year's Academic All-America Hall of Fame class and Dick Enberg Award winner, we see excellence. Three-time first-team all-conference selection. Holds school records in six statistical categories. Three-time Conference Player of the Year. 1,933 career points and 1,635 career rebounds. Two-time first-team All-American. 54-1 team record and three NCAA championships. Five-time NCAA individual champion, ranked number one in the world. Seven-time conference champion. School record holder for four decades. The stories behind the numbers for this year's Academic All-America Hall of Fame honorees are of service, mentorship, achievement, and life-changing decisions made. Rhodes Scholar and infectious disease expert. CEO of one of the largest for-profit health companies. Mentor to young men during their most formative years. Olympic broadcaster and entrepreneur. Pathmaker for first-generation college students. The numbers don't lie, and neither do the accomplishments. Ladies and gentlemen, the CoSIDA Academic All-America Hall of Fame Class of 2022. From Princeton University, Jennifer Babik. From Dartmouth College, Gail Koziara Boudreaux. From the University of Mount Union, Matt Campbell. And from Villanova University, Marty Liquori. And the 2022 Dick Enberg Award winner, from Yale University, Patricia Melton. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome CoSIDA President Cindy Potter.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the CoSIDA Academic All-America Hall of Fame celebration. CoSIDA is proud once again to honor individuals who set a high standard for excellence in the classroom and in competition as student athletes and followed that up with success in their careers and service to their communities. We are grateful for the opportunity to welcome them into membership into this exclusive club. This year's event marks the 35th anniversary of the first Academic All-America Hall of Fame class. That was enshrined in 1988. And as our dear friend and late Dick Enberg was always fond of saying, today we rub shoulders with greatness. The message of the Academic All-America program has resonated through generations of young men and women across the country. And your induction symbolizes the impact you have made on your respective institutions and in society as a whole. We are pleased to partner once again with the NCAA and are most grateful for their support of our signature program. I would like to thank the Vice Presidents of Divisions 2 and 3, Terry Steve Grenou and Louise McCleary, for their support of the program, and thousands of student athletes we honor every year, the accomplished former student athletes and we honor today. On behalf of CoSIDA, the Executive Board of Directors, and our 3,000 plus members, I congratulate these honorees this afternoon and hope that you will continue to support our program for many years to come. Thank you once again and enjoy your lunch. We'll be back for the program shortly. Good afternoon, everyone. Hope everyone enjoyed your lunch or you continue to enjoy your lunch. Welcome once again. Our Master of Ceremonies this afternoon is an Emmy Award-winning college basketball analyst for ESPN, where he works both a game and where he works as both a game and studio analyst. You will also find Sean regularly contributing to SportsCenter, GetUp, and First Take. Prior to ESPN, Sean worked for Fox News, Fox Sports Net, CBS Sports Network, and Fox Sports Radio. He was a student athlete at UCLA, where he was a freshman on the 1997 Pac-10 championship team that advanced to the NCAA Elite Eight. He was named UCLA's Freshman of the Year in 1997, Most Improved Player in 1999, and was a 1999-2000 co-captain. He was chair of the Bruins Athletic Council and twice represented UCLA at the Pac-10 Leadership Forum. He graduated from UCLA in 2000 with a bachelor's degree in history. Upon graduating UCLA, Sean was hired as an assistant coach at Pepperdine and was the youngest full-time assistant in the country at just 22 years old. Sean has been involved with running basketball camps for military children at multiple bases, and more recently has joined the National Board of Coaches for Cancer. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Sean Farnham.
Okay, a couple things I want to clear up. I never worked at Fox News. Just want to make sure, get that out there. Also, when I was a freshman of the year at UCLA, Mark Dellens is here, I believe. Where is the legend himself, Mark Dellens? Mark right there. Mark, don't tell anybody that I was the only freshman on the UCLA basketball team that year. I don't want everybody else to know that, okay? So that just stays between you and me, all right? Mark, it is great to see you. You played such a pivotal role in my experience at UCLA, as so many of you know in here. It's a difficult job that I have now at ESPN. You guys have to deal with me on a consistent basis, all those that work in the sports information world. Like Tyson from BYU. Where's Tyson at from BYU? Where's he at? I think he's here. Where's he at? Back corner. Okay, there, Tyson over there. Yes. Like the ever-pressing question when I show up at the Marriott Center, please, can I have a cougar tail? Now, for some of you, you'd be like, what's he talking about? It's a donut. It's a maple bar. It's like this big, but it's delicious. And I mandate it every single time I go to BYU games that I'm disappointed you didn't bring one for me tonight. I also, you know, you guys have to deal with the difficult questions, such as, can you please pronounce that name one more time for me? I struggle with that. Also, this is my favorite email if any of you work with me. I know you've already sent it, but can you give me the shoot-around schedule one more time? Then there's this one that I'm sure most of you appreciate that deal with me on a consistent basis. I know your game just ended 45 minutes ago and it's Thursday, but are game notes already updated and ready to send out for Saturday's game? On behalf of my colleagues at ESPN and networks beyond, I apologize, and I thank you for all the work that you do to help us be successful and have a great broadcast. You help us tell the stories of today's student-athletes. Those student-athletes will be represented here eventually one day themselves, being inducted into this ceremony. The 2022 CoSIDA event is going to be fantastic. The Academic All-American Hall of Fame ceremony, we recognize four amazing individuals, as well as the presentation of the 2022 Dick Emberg Award. We get started today with the 2022 Lester Jordan Award recipient. Most of you involved with CoSIDA know that we now know as the Academic All-American Program was the brainchild of SMU Athletics Communication Professor Lester Jordan. When Jordan founded the program back in 1952, he became a pioneer in ways and how we could recognize the achievements of the student athletes in competition, in the classroom, and the community that we celebrated. In his honor, the Lester Jordan Award is presented annually to exemplary service of the Academic All-American Award program and promotion of the ideals of being a student athlete. In the absence of the 2020 and 2021 ceremonies, the winners of this prestigious award were recognized during a video presentations during virtual conventions. I'm so glad we're not virtual. Although Zoom was very convenient for many meetings with coaches and stuff like that, I ended up getting a lot of information from coaches during that period of time. Coach Campbell probably did 1,000 Zooms during that period of time. It was fun, right? It's not too bad. It got it done quick. OC could come in. You could come in. Quarterback comes in. Boom. Done. It's nice. But now we're back to in-person, which means we tell stories and we elongate things, and you guys are going, please, can we speed it up? I've got film to get to. The 2020 Lester Jordan Award winner was Bill Jones of Skidmore College, and the 2021 winner was Doug Hochschild of the University of Dayton. If either one is here, please stand up and be recognized. The 2022 winner of the Lester Jordan Award is currently the chair of the Association's Academic All-American Core Committee and has helped shepherd so many of the initiatives and the new nomination and voting procedures that run this program through the pandemic, despite the cancellations of majority of sports over the last two academic seasons. Please welcome the 2022 Lester Jordan Award winner from Rose-Hulman Institute of Technology, Assistant AD for Communications, Kevin Lanke. You have a fan.
I do.
You have a fan. Can we get more than that? Can we get a yeah, Kevin?
There we go.
All right. There we go. Let's step it up a little bit here. Kevin is chair of the Academic All-American Core Committee. You've seen thousands of student-athletes nominated for this prestigious award during their careers. When you see the Hall of Fame inductees that we have here with us today, talk about the importance of this program and what it means to you and to the student-athletes to take home this award year after year.
Today's inductees are the best of the best, and that's what we try to honor with the Academic All-America Award every year. I'm lucky to be a voter for this year's class. We were all unanimous in who should be in here. This is a great class. You're going to learn amazing things about them later in the day. The program itself, this is what we do every year. We honor the best of the best. One of my favorite things we do in the program is have video presentations of the Academic All-Americans of the Year to tell their stories, and it's just awesome. As far as Lester Jordan, I hope I can just honor Lester's thoughts and hopes for this program with everything that I do. 10 years ago, Mark Beckenbach at Ohio Wesleyan called me and said, hey, I want you to be my successor in this position. And all I've tried to do is represent the program the best I can since then. So hopefully Lester's good with that. I want to say a handful of thank yous real quick. First of all, to the Rose-Hulman and Heartland Collegiate Athletic Conference table down in front of us. Thank you very much for your support. Sometimes this takes away from the daily Rose-Hulman work at times of the year, but this program is so vital to everyone on this stage that we have to do that. Also, thank you to my wonderful wife, Steph, who's here, my parents back home, and hi to the Rose-Hulman coaches watching in the SRC. Thank you all very much. Have a great program.
Kevin Lanke, let's give a round of applause. Well, we didn't get the opportunity to induct two classes in person. It is important that we recognize the members of the class of 2020 and 2021. You'll see their names pop up on the monitor over to the right. Both these classes were inducted in virtual sessions, as we talked about. So much has been virtual, including school for some of us. But that's the class of 2020, and then the class of 2021 as well. The Academic All-American Hall of Fame accounts among its members, leaders in business, medicine, political science, philanthropy, science, just to name a few of the disciplines. Each year, we are fortunate to welcome back past inductees to this event. If you are a Hall of Fame member and you are here today, can you please stand and be recognized? I believe we know at least of one. There it is, right there. Boom. Thank you, Terry. Appreciate you being here. Your continued support of this great program is essential. CoSIDA Academic All-American Program recognizes more than 1,600 student-athletes annually with the Academic All-American Honors, and nearly 4,000 total student-athletes earn Academic All-District accolades. Student-athletes from every championship sport in the NCAA and NAIA are eligible for Academic All-American consideration. Since the program's inception, over 30,000 student athletes have earned Academic All-American honors, Including this year's induction class, though, only 168 have been chosen for Academic All-America Hall of Fame. Exclusive company that you are being put into today by this recognition at this event. The 2022 induction class will now join the previous honorees of the Academic All-American Hall of Fame with recognition on plaques that are permanently displayed at the NCAA Hall of Champions in Indianapolis. Perfect timing, by the way, Lori. By the way, Lori's done a great job. Can we give a round of applause to Lori? They don't trust me to stay on time, just so you know. So I have to keep, like, if you see me tapping my phone, it's not because I'm getting text messages or posting anything on Instagram or social media or concerned about my brand, name, image, and likeness or anything of the likeness. It's literally because I'm looking at the clock going, gotta stay on time, gotta stay on time. And we are on time, which is a good thing. I know that makes everybody else happy right now as well. All right, our first inductee was a pioneer both on the basketball court and in the healthcare field. The only three-time Women's Basketball Player of the Year in the Ivy League history. She was a two-sport star All-American at Dartmouth College and still holds 23 Big Green school records for her prowess on the hardwood. A two-time Academic All-American honoree, she was recognized as a member of the NCAA's Silver Anniversary in 2007 and received the association's highest honor, the Theodore Roosevelt Award, earlier this year. She graduated with a bachelor's degree in psychology and an MBA from Columbia. That's pretty good. As the chief executive officer of Elevance, a Fortune 20 health company, she has made an indelible impact on our nation's healthcare system. Recognized as one of Fortune magazine's most powerful women in business and featured by Forbes as one of the top 100 most powerful women in the world. She was the recipient in 2018 of the Women's Sports Foundation's Billie Jean King Leadership Award from Dartmouth College, Gail Koziara Boudreaux. Gail is unable to be with us in person today, but will join us momentarily for a live interview via that ever so friendly Zoom link that we now socially can distance ourselves with. Accepting the award on her behalf is Dartmouth Senior Associate AD, Tiffany Sykes. Thank you so much, Tiffany.
Thank you so much, Tiffany.
Gail, I believe that you are with us. Can you hear me, Gail?
Can you hear me, Gail?
I can. Good afternoon, Sean.
We are honored to have you joining us. We wish you were here, but we understand, obviously, there are circumstances and things that pull you away and prohibited you from being here with us today. The numbers you amassed speak for themselves. Nearly 2,000 points, 1,700 rebounds. What is your fondest memory of a student athlete at Dartmouth, especially at your time when women's sports was really emerging on the national landscape?
Well, there's so many great memories, but before I answer that question, I really just want to first thank the committee for this incredible honor, and I'm truly sorry that I was unable to join you for the celebration in person, but it is an amazing honor that I'm really proud to receive. You know, as I think about the experiences, I think there's a theme, actually, as I was thinking through what were those pivotal moments in my athletic career. And the theme was really around teammates, those long bus rides, the time we spent arguing about issues, you know, common goal. It was really the people who've become some of my best friends after graduating from college. Those were the moments. Athletically, one of the most important moments was a turning point in our program when we won the Ivy League championship my sophomore year against a lot of odds. We had a lot of players hurt. We had 7 or 8 healthy players only. We weren't projected to be good. We had, you know, really we're just building the program. And it was such a turning point for all of us. And I just remember the work and the excitement and the belief that we could accomplish something. And I've always thought about that in terms of what is possible. So those are the type of things. And then for me personally, I think the National Track Championship my senior year, where I was able to become an All-American and beat my personal best in my last throw. Those are two sports memories that really are foundational.
Yeah, it's a good transition for you. You mentioned we talk so much about the basketball numbers, but also the shot put and the discus and track and field.
You were a two-sport star. How did that lesson that you learned, maybe by being a two-sport athlete, help influence your professional career?
Yeah, there are so many lessons you learn in sports, and I know we all talk about it. Being a two-sport athlete, I think some of the basic things around time management and focus, setting priorities, being able to manage through multiple things. You know, my career, I think about managing a firm of over 100,000 associates and the complexity of the industry and the challenges that we faced through the pandemic over the last few years. It's really the skills of putting the best team out there, finding the right people who have different roles. And I learned a lot of that playing during my college athletic days. And I learned how to really create, both with my psychology degree, the importance of really getting people to focus on a few key priorities and always believing you can accomplish more. And those are the kinds of things that I've taken with me throughout my career. And I've always challenged myself and our team to do more, to believe that we could be incredibly successful. And you know that failure in athletics isn't the end, that you have another chance. And those are the kinds of lessons, I think, in business that are so important for us, because it isn't fatal when you don't. You get another chance. You learn more and you take those lessons and you put them into practice. And I think that that virtuous cycle is really important. And it's been an important lesson for me in my professional career as well as through athletics.
The pandemic certainly has created a historic challenges for the entire world, but certainly really challenging when you're working in the healthcare world like you do. What have been some of the toughest challenges that you have faced while leading Evolence, and what lessons has the pandemic taught us about the future of healthcare?
The pandemic has been such an unusual experience for all of us, but I think about a crisis as an opportunity to really think differently on how we deliver, differently on how the healthcare industry can go beyond what has been a fairly slow-moving industry and really become much more consumer-centric, be more agile, move with speed. And I'm really proud of what we've been able to do at Evolence Health, because we were able to face some of these unprecedented challenges. Now, for us, the pandemic reminded us of a core belief, which is the power of purpose. Our purpose is to improve the health of humanity, and it was really our North Star throughout the pandemic. And I think about, again, the connection back to athletics and sports. And what we learned there is the belief in yourself, the belief in your team. And that's really what we took throughout the pandemic in healthcare, how we deliver, how we partner, how we serve, and how we evolve to really meet a very, very different changing environment. You know, in terms of the future of healthcare, the pandemic has validated the importance of many of the healthcare strengths and strategies that we're pursuing as a company. The importance of access to care, of meeting our consumers where they are, increasing virtual and telehealth options, and the power of digital solutions. So I think there are a lot of lessons from that, and that's part of the leadership that we helped maneuver through this pandemic, and we're still in it. So it's one of the great opportunities that, again, we continually learn in a crisis. It's a great opportunity for us to continue to evolve and transform ourselves.
We'd be remiss if we didn't acknowledge the fact that it was 50 years ago this month that the passage of Title IX was put into place that granted equal access for young women to play college sports. Can you adequately describe how Title IX changed your life? And if you had one message of advice for today's female student athletes moving forward, how can they pay back Title IX and continue to enhance the experience and the representation of females in sports?
Paying it forward is incredibly important. It's something for me, both professionally and as an athlete, I think is critically important. And I'm very involved in that. So I think about Title IX. It was an incredibly important moment of equality for women, especially in sports. It was not only changed women's sports forever, but it also improved the trajectory of women's lives. So I think about the impact that Title IX has, that you think about the CEOs today, many of businesswomen, over 90% have participated in some type of athletics. It gives you that confidence. It gives you the opportunity to take on challenges, to not be afraid of competitive environments. So my advice to young women who played sports, it is important. It's important to take the skills that you've learned. It's important to pay it forward for the next generation. Get involved in youth sports. Really help this next generation understand the importance of the platform that we all have. And I benefited from so many mentors through my time in both business and sports. And Title IX was the great opportunity for all of us to be on an equal playing field. So I owe a lot to the people who came before me that helped pave the way. And I think this current generation has that same opportunity to really pay it forward for the next generation. But we still have a lot to do. We made great progress in Title IX, but there's still a lot more work to do. And I think we all have to lean in on the opportunities that are in front of us and make our voices heard.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, she may not be here, so let's give a lot of noise and let her know how much we celebrate this moment with her. From Dartmouth College, Gail, Koziara, Boudreaux, thank you so much and congratulations.
A number of years ago, they instituted the honorary category here at the Hall of Fame ceremony, recognizing student athletes that would have been academic All-Americans had the program existed in the time in which they were competing. Our next Hall of Fame inductee was a world record holder during his storied collegiate career in track and field and cross country at Villanova University. A five-time individual NCAA champion, four of those crowns came in the mile, where he became just the fourth person to win three consecutive outdoor national titles. When I was doing my research on it, I was just thinking of me doing Orange Theory, and when they do like some of those challenge runs, and thinking to myself, there's no chance. How fast would the treadmill have to go to be able to run the times that he was running back in the 60s and 70s? And I just be honest, I cannot do it. The member of the Wildcats 1971 national champion cross-country squad, he ranked number one in the world in the 1500 meters in both 1969 and 1971. 26 times ran sub 4 minute miles, 26 times. He was the youngest person to advance to the finals of that event in the 1968 Summer Olympics in Mexico City. He was a commentator in three ABC Olympic telecasts. He was the co-founder of Athletic Attic, a chain of running stores, and has served as a spokesperson for Leukemia Society of America's team in training initiative. Please welcome from Villanova University, Marty Liquori. Joining Marty on stage for the award presentation is Senior Associate Athletic Director and Senior Women's Administrator, Lynn Tai. Marty already showing leadership, saying we should turn these chairs to face each other a little bit more. It might be more comfortable.
Well, I thought that might be the way to go.
Yeah. Hey, I'm just disappointed. What happened to the mustache? Because when we were showing those pictures early, I mean, that was a high-level stash.
You remember Raleigh Fingers?
Yes, I do.
You weren't born.
I'm from the Bay Area.
Okay, well, Raleigh had the handlebar mustache. I had one for a long time.
Yeah. It's fantastic. Sideburns are great, too. If we put it back up the graphic, we can look at the sideburns. These are the things that I notice as we're going through the process.
These are the things your kids will notice.
Yeah, well, you know, that's why I have three children. All right. Listen, you competed at a time that produced so many elite-level athletes, yourself included. What made you want to focus in on the mile, the 1500?
That's an interesting question because I never even thought about it. It was like it was preordained. I ran a four-minute mile in high school, chased it for 3 years, and then I went to Villanova, which was known for producing milers. You mentioned there are only a couple guys who won three NCAA championships in a row. One was Ron Delaney from Villanova. Dave Patrick before me had won two. After me, Sidney Marie, Eamon Coghlan. So we produced milers, and I never really thought about it till you came up with that probing question. But I did realize towards the end of my career I was in the wrong event all along, that I really was a longer distance runner. But when you know, the mile and the 100 meters were the showcase of track and field, and where you're a miler, you're not getting any invitations to run any other event. So I went with it as long as I could.
We talk about the number of championships in which you won individually, and obviously a great experience at Villanova to be able to represent and win a national championship. Outside of that, though, your decision to attend Villanova and the impact that that's had on your life, away from just your experiences within the athletic world of Villanova, what do you remember most about your time on campus?
Well, picking the college really came down to who was the coach. Yeah. Running and swimming are very scientific sports, and you have to have a coach who understands the physiology. And Jumbo Elliott was a coach at the time. He'd been successful at Villanova for 20 years. So really, the fact that Villanova had a beautiful campus, it was only about a mile long, that Gail talked about time management. I learned years after when I visited other campuses when I was broadcasting that Villanova was like this perfect storm where we got out of bed and we walked 50 yards to class, and then we walked 50 yards to our morning workout, and then we went 50 yards to eat. At the time, there were no women, so there weren't those distractions. And the team was a cohesive team. They all lived together. And so that was the little beautiful thing that Villanova was. I didn't appreciate it at the time, but I realized years later that that was a big part of the success for that program.
You ran, obviously, on the biggest of stages. We talk about the Olympics. What did it mean representing the country in the 1968 Olympics?
Well, again, the sport of swimming and track and field are a little bit different. You played basketball, and you know you've got half the people in L.A. rooting against you and the other half from SC rooting against you and the other half rooting for you. But I learned really early on that when you're representing your country, there's a lot more pressure. You mentioned I went to the Olympics in 1968. And I made the final, but I was last in the final. But the thing I came away with that from, and I felt bad about to this day, was that Jim Ryan, who should have won the Olympics in Mexico City, but it was an impossibility for him because it was held at high altitude. And he ran an amazing race and finished second to Kip Kano. But when he came back to the United States, people were terrible to him, because he had let the country down. They didn't understand the sport, and he had to live with that. And I think he actually kind of retired for a year or two to get over it. So to answer your question, I think there's a lot of pressure on you. I in the Olympics, was the first time I ever ran outside of the United States or an international race. So I'm used to running against, you know, nice American kids. And you get into an international race like the Olympics, and you realize that guy from Poland has his whole country depending on him, and that guy from Africa has his whole village depending on him. And when the gun goes off, they are not afraid to knock you over. So you better be ready for the, how can I say this? There are no rules. It's what you can get away with.
The first rule of the mile in the Olympics says there is no rule.
Be ready.
There you go. You ran your personal best in May of 1971. Then you were injured, and you missed a substantial amount of time, and then returned back to the sport, breaking that personal record in 1975. What did you learn about yourself in that time away from the sport in the mental aspect of the excellence that you were able to compete with?
Right. Well, I learned a lot about myself, but I learned something that I try to impress on every athlete that I've ever been associated with, that if your career were just a straight line up and you never got injured, that just doesn't happen. The champions are made when they get injured. A lot of people get injured and say, hey, I'm injured now. I can, for the next 2 weeks, the doctor told me I can't run. I'm going to catch up on Netflix and stuff like that. But the real champion realizes, oh, no, I'm injured. I can't run for 2 hours a day. I have to get in the pool for 2 hours, then I have to get an exercise bike for an hour. Then I have to lift weights. In other words, you have to increase your work when you're hurt, and then when you come back, you're ready to pick up where you left off.
You've built an incredibly successful business career and continue to make an impact in the community in so many different ways. What advice would you give today's student athletes in as they approach and try to make the most out of the opportunities that are right there in front of them right now?
How are we doing on time?
I don't know, Lori, how much time do we have? Okay, we got to continue. Keep going.
Well, One of the reasons I appreciate this so much, it's always been a dream of mine to be recognized for something other than having run a fast mile. And that kind of happened once when I read about Dr. Spock. We didn't have a whole lot of books in my house when I grew up, but we definitely had Dr. Spock's book. And my mother used that to bring me up, and probably a lot of the people in this room were brought up by Dr. Spock. But then I found out that Dr. Spock had won an Olympic gold medal in 1924. And I thought, this is the way it should be, that your athletic feats are overshadowed by what you accomplish in life. So that's always been a goal for me, to do something that you'll be remembered for, and that a person in sports should realize that the end of their sport career is not the end of anything. It's the beginning of the rest of their life, where they use all those things which Gail stole, all my great stuff I was going to tell you, about the lessons you learn. When you use all those lessons that you learn to do something in the world that makes a difference and maybe helps people forget that you are an athlete.
I'll say, ladies and gentlemen, Marty Liquori. Earlier today, we honored one of the all-time great Ivy League basketball student-athletes, and now it's our time to turn our attention to the sport of softball and recognize another Ivy legend. Our next inductee led Princeton to the 1995 Women's College World Series, the first and only Ivy League institution that has reached the NCAA Division I softball championships. She was a four-time all-conference selection and still holds the career several career records and season program and conference records. A Rhodes Scholar, she received a PhD in psychology sciences from Oxford and was the winner of Princeton's University Pine Prize, awarded to the senior who had the most clearly manifested excellent scholarship strength of character and effective leadership. She was a five-time academic all-Ivy League selection in softball and field hockey, played the alto saxophone. She will play for us in just a matter of minutes. I don't know if they told her that. Did they not tell you that? They didn't tell you that? Oh, shoot. Okay, well, there's got to be a saxophone somewhere around here. We'll just go grab it, and it'll be smooth. In the university's jazz ensemble, the NCAA postgraduate scholarship and was selected to Academic All-America three times. She graduated with a bachelor's degree in molecular biology and completed medical school at Stanford. She is currently the associate professor of medicine at the University of California, San Francisco, where she specializes in clinical infectious diseases. Anybody want to ask her how her last 20 months was? Please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, from Princeton University, Jennifer Babik. Joining Jennifer on stage for the award presentation are Assistant Athletic Director of Communication, Chaz Dorman, and Senior Associate Director of Athletics, Allison Rich. Women's College World Series just ended a couple of weeks ago, and it's great for ESPN. Amy will appreciate this, as I represent ESPN here just ever so slightly. The numbers continue to grow in the viewership year after year. First time a game was on ABC this year for women's softball, which is a huge movement and shift as we continue to try to draw more attention to all student athletes. But it's a sport dominated primarily by Power Five conferences. What did it mean to be on that team back in 1995 to represent the Ivy League, not just Princeton, on that big of a stage?
Yeah, it was an amazing experience. I think, you know, Gail mentioned this earlier as well. It was really, we had a core belief that we could get to the World Series. We had a belief that when we got there, we deserved to be there, and it was just really wonderful. My time on that team, it was just such a cohesive group of young women, and we spent a lot of time together. A lot of us were best friends. We're still very close friends to this day, and we just had a lot of fun. We did a lot of long bus rides, as Gail alluded to. I think actually our longest ride was up to Dartmouth to play softball, and we just were very cohesive. We had this, can I tell a story, Sean?
You can.
We had this fabric doll. It actually had a ridiculous name. Its name was Baby Poo Poo. And it was this fabric doll, and it was given to the freshman class to protect, and the upperclassmen would try to steal Baby Poo Poo. And she ended up like tied to the train track. She was held for ransom. The best was that she was tied to the flagpole of our softball field, and it happened to be picture day. So there's actually one of our team pictures where she's flying off the flagpole, which is really fabulous. But I think what we learned is that hard work and fun can really coexist. It was really wonderful.
If you had Baby Poo Poo on your bingo square, go ahead and mark that off now. Thank you. Just want to make sure. Like so many, you were named a Rhodes Scholar. The intensity of the academic experience, how did you balance that at Princeton? You know, like for a lot of people, you hear the rigors academically of an Ivy League institution, and then you put on top of it the intensity and the rigors of your athletic competition. How did you balance those things?
Yeah, I think, again, Gail, as Marty said, Gail, I think, stole a lot of what we were going to talk about. But, you know, time management was an important lesson that we learned as student athletes at Princeton. And we would, you know, go to class, then we would go to practice, and then we would all eat dinner together, and then we would all head over to the library. And I have such fond memories of being in the Princeton library with my teammates and kind of walking back on cold, you know, snowy nights in New Jersey. And it was really just, you kind of did what you could with the time that you had. And so maybe we didn't kind of do as many other things as maybe some of our classmates, but it was just really wonderful. Kind of as a team, we did a lot of our academics together and we did our sports together. And it was really amazing experience.
Your journey has taken you all over the world as a student athlete, as a student, as a professional. What would you say to today's student athlete that, in particular, in the last couple of years, has started to find their voice maybe a little bit more of how they can empower themselves, be part of their community, and bring about change?
Yeah, I think being really confident and having a belief in yourself and not allowing people to tell you you can't do something. When I was growing up, one of my kind of main coaches told me that I was too short to play Division I softball. And I am short, but at the time I kind of found this to be shocking news. And I think I just had to get over that. And I think there are many reasons that someone might be told they can't do something, where you're from, what your connections are, you know, how, what your size is or whatever. And I think just having a confidence in yourself that you can overcome that and that you have a belief in yourself.
We mentioned this with Gail. Obviously, you know, ESPN, they continue to run the talk about the Title IX and the 50th anniversary of that. So many trailblazers that have led the way. Your team, a trailblazing team, and what you were able to accomplish, your success both as a student athlete and now in the professional world, a trailblazing leader in that regard for others to want to follow and emulate. How would, when addressing today's student athletes and discussion point of Title IX, what would you want them to know about it, and what would you want them to focus on as they move forward?
You know, I think I have such a deep appreciation for the women who came before me, who have kind of blazed this trail, and it was really a difficult road for them to travel. And I think it has created this amazing opportunity. I mean, kind of what we're all talking about now is just the amazing opportunity I feel like I personally had at Princeton and growing up being able to play sports and all of the lessons that we've been talking about that we've learned from sports in terms of teamwork, collaboration, etc. And I just feel so grateful to the women who came before me. And I think, you know, Gail said it very well in terms of paying it forward and just being sure to think about the generations that are coming after you.
Okay, this is the hardest hitting question I'm going to ask you. You ready?
I'm ready.
Best talent, softball or saxophone playing?
I'm going to go with softball.
Okay, yeah. I figured.
I was okay on the saxophone, though. I was ready.
She'll be at the lounge later on tonight down in that center area as you're walking past that little sandwich place as you're walking back to your hotel. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give it up one more time for Jennifer Babik. Our final Hall of Fame honoree was a member of one of the most successful college football programs at any level as a standout defensive end at the University of Mount Union. He was a two-time All-American selection in 2001 and 2002. He was named to the Associated Press Little America squad as a senior while also earning the AFCA first team accolades. During the course of his career, the Purple Raiders won 54 of 55 games played, along with 4 Ohio Athletic Conference crowns and 3 NCAA Division III national championships. Under the tutelage of legendary coach Larry Karras, an academic All-American honoree during his senior campaign, he was inducted into Mount Union Hall of Fame back in 2018. His success on the gridiron has continued to the coaching ranks, first at the University of Toledo and now at his current position as head coach of Iowa State University, where he has guided the Cyclones to national prominence with five straight winning seasons and bowl game appearances. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome from the University of Mount Union, Matt Campbell. Joining Matt on stage for the award presentation is former Mount Union Assistant Athletic Director and Sports Information Director, Lenny Reich. The sideburns were awesome.
I knew you were coming.
Come on. The sideburns are awesome. I mean, you guys can't see it, but the graphic is still up here. I don't know if we can put the graphic back up there or not. But the sideburn game was really strong. What was the inspiration for the sideburns?
Geez, I think the show 90210 was out there, you know, and I think one of those characters.
Little Luke Perry-ish?
Yeah, Luke Perry, yeah. Absolutely.
I'm not mad at you for that. you know, obviously, you know, you talk about how much winning success you had, 54 of 55 games. What do you remember most about how that team was able to achieve at that elite of a level?
Yeah, you know, I think the first thing that you said is a legendary coach. And, you know, we were maybe one of the great all-time coaches in the history of sport. And Coach Karras created this dynasty that, you know, so unique. There wasn't a lot of mantra, not a lot of mottos, but there was one side in the locker room and it said faith, family, football. And here was this gentleman who has got one of the greatest winning percentages in all sport. And he had the humility and character to really continue to lead through that foundational value system. And, you know, I think the other value system of this unique ability to get the most out of his players with the kind of the mantra of the person is greater than the player. And, you know, uniquely for me, I got to come back and coach for him for 2 years and to watch him lead young men and then watch him lead coaches with the value system of the person. It was really powerful for all of us.
Is that what you take away most from your experience at the Division III level that now applies to what you're doing at Iowa State?
No, I think it's been the root of who we have become at Iowa State. And, you know, we talk a lot about in our program being a transformational program, not a transactional program. And, you know, in the college football world, especially at our level, I think it's easy to get very transactional really fast. And yet we have tried to really double down on the transformational journey of how do we create this experience for young 18 to 22 years old, 2-year-old young men, and how do we allow them to grow as young men and then leave as men and be ready to go be great fathers and husbands, community servants, and have this opportunity to grow in a culture where we love, care, serve, and empower these young men to become the best version of themselves that they can be.
Now, Coach doesn't know this is the first time we've ever met, but for those of you that you guys watch sports, you hear quotes, and coaches have great quotes. You know, come after me, I'm a man, I'm 40. You know, that's a famous quote that we all remember, right? Coach didn't say that one, by the way. That's another coach. But often what I do is I watch sports, and I hear these quotes from press conferences, and every now and then there's a quote that moves me. And I write it down, and I think I wrote this one down correctly that he said not that long ago. But you said, greatness is just for the chosen few. Greatness is for those who choose to be different and demand to become the best version of themselves. You demand that of your program every single day. How have the skills that you obtained as a student athlete empower your team to be able to live by that, play with that mantra of striving for greatness?
Yeah, you know, I think it's creating a standard for yourself of excellence that you demand daily. And, you know, the cliche term that we all use, and I certainly Coach Saban's used, and you've heard the word process. And I do think there is a process to greatness, and there's a process to reaching your full potential. And the beginning part of that process is understanding what's really important to you and why it's important to you. and then having the ability to align your goals and your value systems to achieving those goals, and knowing that, you know, there are going to be tough and trying times, adversity is coming, and yet we're going to have the opportunity to be able to overcome those because of that value system that we have. And so, you know, I think that's what we talk a lot about within our program, and certainly the value system that I took from my experience at Mount Union with great coaches and obviously great teammates.
You bring up Nick Saban, of course, Jimbo Fisher. We'll talk about that in just a couple of, no, I'm just kidding. Mental health issues have become a talking point for student athletes. The pressure coming out of the post-pandemic. In your program, how do you try to make yourself not just a leader on the sideline that calls plays and runs a great program, but from a person that's checking in on a daily basis for the health of your student athletes?
Yeah, and I think that goes back to that value of the person is greater than the player. And, you know, I think so many times in our sport, especially at our level at times, you want to get to the win or to the game, and yet you have to realize you're dealing with 18-year-old young people and now a father of four children. You realize how important that when a family drops off a young person in your hands, your responsibility is not only just as the football player, but as the human being. And, you know, we talk a lot about in our program relationships and the ability to get to know young people, what makes them tick, how can we help them through this journey, that there are going to be tough and trying times. And honestly, with the level of our sport and what comes at these young men today, the mental health challenge continues to be there. And I think keeping an open door policy, being available, not sitting in my office all day, but being out with our players, I think it's a huge opportunity for us to make a huge impact on their lives on a day in and day out basis.
Okay, you won 54 out of 55 games. You had those sideburns we talked about earlier, right? What would your NIL be worth right now?
Man, I think about that quite often right now, especially with those sideburns. So, different time in a different era, we could have made a lot of money.
It would have been unbelievable. That meant posters everywhere across America. Ladies and gentlemen, Matt Campbell.
I never had that sideburn, gang. I wish I did. I think I might probably look silly, though. I can't pull it off. Coach had those big muscles, too, when he was playing. It was just different. Our final award for the 2022 Hall of Fame ceremony is the 2022 Dick Emberg Award, established in 1997. Dick Emberg Award was given annually to a person whose actions and commitment have furthered the meaning and reach of the Academic All-America program, and a student-athlete who promoted the values of education and academics. The award was created in part to recognize Dick's passion and sport as support of Academic All-American program for over 30 years. More importantly, his dedication to education for more than four decades. The list of previous Emberg Award honorees include Olympic athletes, Hall of Fame coaches, cabinet members, and presidents of the United States. The 2020 winner, Knight Commission CEO Amy Perko. The 2021 winner, legendary tennis player and women's rights activist Billie Jean King. I will tell you, as a young broadcaster, one of the greatest nights of my life, that I learned so much about this business and learned so much how to treat people, was a night in Anaheim, California during the NCAA tournament when I got a call from Jay Billis, who at the time was calling games for CBS for the NCAA tournament. He said, Sean, why don't you come watch the games and then hang out with me and Dick Enberg back at the hotel. I barely slept. We stayed up a long, long time. And the stories that I was told, the careful nature in which this man loves sport, I've tried to embody every single day that I work in this profession, and I try to pay that forward every single day because of the greatness that Dick Emberg is and was. We are pleased to be joined today by Dick's son. At this time, please join me in welcoming Ted Emberg.
Good afternoon. I'm Ted Emberg, son of late Dick Emberg. And in a world where we often highlight the negative, I mean, how great is it today that we get to show some positive news in this world? So let's hear for everyone. It is truly wonderful to be here today. despite how the blackjack table treated me last night, to present this year's recipient of the Dick Enberg Award. The Dick Enberg Award started over 30 years ago, based on my dad's profound passion for academics, athletics, and his love of the Academic All-America program. But really underlying that was my dad's deep appreciation for education and the opportunities that it granted him. While growing up in Mount Clemens, Michigan, my dad couldn't afford college and was fortunate to receive financial help from Central Michigan. Is Central Michigan in the house today? No, okay. A few hundred dollars from Central Michigan. He got this financial aid due to his outstanding grades in his high school class of 20. During his junior year at Central Michigan, my dad was trying to make some money and luckily found an ad for a janitor position at a local radio station. When he went in to apply for the janitor position, the radio director asked him to step into the booth and read a news and sports report cold, no practice. A few days later, my dad received a call notifying him that he got the position. Excited to start his new career as a janitor, the gentleman corrected him and said that he had actually gotten the job as the disc jockey, which would initiate the first steps in his career towards being a broadcaster. Both janitor and disc jockey paid $1 a day. It was the educational opportunity that opened that door to his dreams. He was a Central Michigan Chippewa fan for life after that. Education became his foundation, and he took that as far as he could, even getting his PhD at Indiana University in physical education while announcing Hoosiers basketball, which would lead to an opportunity to call UCLA basketball during the era of legendary coach John Wooden. Education creates opportunities. Just as my dad's respect for education and institutions was strong, so was the idea of service. In fact, a year or so before my dad passed away, he was even considering going back to teaching at the college level at University of Kentucky, always feeling that there was still more service left to give the world. When I first started broadcasting, he would tell me all the time to be of service. He would say, "Ted, make sure to service the game, service the audience, service the game," meaning that just because you get to call the game doesn't mean that the game or any part of it should be about you. You are only there to service the audience and the players of the game. Don't get it confused, Ted. Over his career, it really didn't matter if he was courtside or in the booth with Magic Johnson or John McEnroe or some other great. My dad always kept the service mentality of being just a fan of the sport with the privilege of sitting next to an athlete while they got the chance to watch the game together. It is my dad's deep respect for education, service, and his love of athletics that continues to drive this award forward even after he has left us. And today, we get to continue his passion for recognizing these rare traits in others with the exemplary and storied career of someone who has gone above and beyond with the themes of athletics, education, and service. As the president of New Haven Promise, she has overseen the disbursement of more than $25 million to 2,200 students throughout the city of New Haven, Connecticut over the last decade. Those students have largely been first-generation, low-income students of color, just as she had been in her hometown of Cleveland. A seven-time Ivy League champion after walking on to the track and field team at Yale University, she earned All-America honors for the Bulldogs and is a former United States Olympic Trials finalist. The national runner-up in the 400 meters, she received the Nellie Elliott Award, which is the highest honor in her Yale undergraduate class in 1982. Her top 400 meter time currently remains a school record to this day and served as the Ivy League standard for nearly two decades. She joined Gail Bordeaux as a member of the 2007 NCAA Silver Anniversary Team and was the first African-American woman to be awarded Yale's George H.W. Bush Award in 2013. Now, the accolades she's received from her peers, from her alma mater, and world leaders such as former President Barack Obama reflect the shared passion and commitment to academics that my dad had. And her selection as the 26th recipient of the award that bears his name is most appropriate. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming from Yale University, Patricia Melton.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Brought up the president and the role that you have as president of the New Haven Promise. We talk about inequities and inequities in education and healthcare, and things have become much more openly talked about and discussed. How important is it for you to take on the leadership role that you have had to help change the lives of so many?
Well, I think it's very important. When I look at athletics or any of our roles in our community, there's so many needs out there. I come from a fairly poor community. I grew up in the projects. And I must say that what I've come to understand is that talent is equally distributed, but the opportunity to develop that talent is not. And so that's where it's just very important, certainly for us in the athletic field, on the field, to really use those skills that we've developed to really make our society a better place.
When you talk about the how you were raised and then to go to an institution like Yale, what were some of the apprehensions or maybe feelings that you had as you showed up onto campus that now after you've left and so many years looking back on, you're so proud of the way that you were able to accomplish and compete at such a high level in the athletic world and academically as well?
Well, I would say that I was looking through my sixth grade graduation book. I did a TED talk recently. And you know how it says, you know, your best chum, your best this, your best that. And in there it said college. And what I had written, scribbled, and I have very terrible handwriting, is community. Community, because I didn't know the name of a college, but I had heard, at least in my neighborhood, that folks went to community. Actually, it was Cuyahoga Community College. So to get into a place like Yale was, I didn't know anything about Yale, but going to school and having gone to Middlesex school and an independent school on scholarship to really develop my talent from my neighborhood was critically important. So that a place like Yale is something that I do in my work now. Many kids walk past Yale and have walked past Yale, but now through this scholarship program, we have roughly 35 kids at Yale, 300 kids at UConn, 300 kids at Southern Connecticut State University. We literally have 800 kids, which is practically the size of our high schools in college, and that's huge. So, you know, a place like Yale that funds the scholarship, hugely important.
I've been to Yale once because Bristol, Connecticut's not that far away from New Haven. And so I drove down just to see the campus one time. I was blown away by the uniqueness of the layout and the facilities and the storied tradition of those bricks and those buildings and what it feels like when you walk on campus. And, you know, UCLA is a beautiful campus, but there's something about the Ivy League schools that's a little bit different. When you were there as a student, what were some of the obstacles or hurdles that you overcame to really thrive the way that you did?
Well, I would say, again, coming from a first generation to college, my mother dropped out of high school to start a family, so it was really a very foreign idea. Going to a place like Yale, there were just many firsts. I was an independent student at Yale, and so that is, I was only one of two kids who were independent students, meaning that I was financially responsible for myself, and there was one other friend who was responsible for themselves. So, you know, a place like Yale that, you know, on average back then, most of the kids were from middle class to upper middle class backgrounds. There were, you know, a small percentage of students who were students of color. You know, today it's very different. So I would say that there were a lot of barriers, but where I found my home was in the athletic department. So I wanted to go to a place like Yale because it was very well known for its athletics. But academics were also very important as well.
You talk about your successes, as Ted was talking about, your accomplishments, the school record that you still own today. What does that mean to you to still have that school record today?
If it wasn't for COVID, I would not have that record. So that's what I want to say. But, you know, just like Gail and others when it comes to Title IX, I mean, when I went to Yale, I did not know that I was a pioneer at the time. You know, I was recruited as a field hockey and lacrosse player. I ended up competing for, you know, an Olympian who was a coach at the time, Lee Calhoun. And I was, you know, literally, it was just stars in my eyes that I could compete for someone who I had literally watched on television, you know, watching the Olympics. So, you know, when you really look at, you know, how important it is, you know, being there and being able to compete at a place like Yale, it's just, you know, it's just phenomenal. And no, I did not know I was a pioneer at that time. But now that I look at that record, you know, what I would say is that we don't know, it's just important to keep moving forward, whatever you're doing, to bring your best self, because you really are making an incredible difference in society, and particularly for our young kids who look up to so much of what we do. We're modeling that, and particularly in athletics, you know, inner-city kids just worship athletes. So it's just it's very important. We are those role models, and I would say that the athletic department, athletics at Yale, provided that stability for me and gave me that pathway into my career.
Who are the leaders that you? I mean, you're a leader in yourself, but like, who are some of the people that you look at to that inspire you in your leadership style?
Well, I would say, you know, I think of folks like, some historical figures like Harriet Tubman, Barack Obama, Oprah Winfrey. I mean, there are just so many examples out there. I think that it is that incredible resilience, selflessness that folks have to make a difference, to know that, you know, our time here on this earth is really very short, but we can make a huge impact. And that's what I really love about being part of this community, this athletic community. I didn't know, I thought I was just competing for 4 years, but really we are all part of an incredible community that goes for a lifetime. I got to meet Gail in 2007, and I've seen familiar faces over the years, and I just marvel that we are doing what we're doing to, you know, make a difference in this world and to bring into leadership that younger generation that looks up to us.
As I've asked multiple times today, the 50th anniversary of Title IX, as you've watched athletics evolve and grow as a viable means to an end for so many to create that opportunity, because that opportunity is huge, to have the opportunity to attend college and participate and compete and be mm-hmm. part of a team. It's so empowering in so many different ways. How do you see that in today's world for young women, as we talk about some of the things that you're doing right now in your work, but also just as a motivational factor to create those opportunities more often and more frequently?
Well, I think Title IX has been hugely different. When I was at Yale, like I said, it was in the early pioneer days. I didn't know it was pioneer days, but it was the pioneer days. And as I've stayed involved, you know, as an alum with the school and just looking at athletes, female athletes, it's just amazing the opportunity that it has presented, both in career as well as in life. You know, as Gail had such a great statistic around the women who are in their careers, who have competed in sports, it's because of all those really core values, resiliency, selflessness, you know, learning how to fail, because certainly in athletics, there's always someone who's gonna get your record. They haven't gotten mine yet, but they will get your record. And so it's really about a community much bigger when it comes to, you know, making a difference. And I would say that women still, you know, girls still have a long way to go. You know, we know that women make, what, 75-80% on the dollar of a man. I think that we have so much more potential to develop in women, and athletics is such a terrific platform to do that.
Ladies and gentlemen, Patricia Melton.
This has been an outstanding event today with stories and memories from outstanding former student athletes and difference makers of today. Our sincere congratulations to all the honorees. They will be available for a short period of time for a meet and greet immediately following the luncheon towards the back where their pictures are located in the back of the room. We'd also ask the inductees after that meet and greet if you could please come to the stage to take a picture together. That would be outstanding. We'd appreciate that. Thank you all for attending today's Academic All-America Hall of Fame ceremony, and we look forward to seeing you next year in 2023 in Orlando, Florida. Thank you so much for allowing me to have the opportunities, and to all the sports information directors that are here, those that like me, those that don't like me. I appreciate you very, very much, and I look forward to working with you again next season.